That very much. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, if you would, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I prepared a message yesterday or the day before, and I really kept coming back to this message here, and the Lord just continued to lay it on my heart. And I want to preach a message this morning, very simple. It's about the gospel. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 1 says this, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." Let's pray. Oh Lord, I pray that you would speak to our hearts this morning. Lord, I pray that every single one of us would be moved by what we hear today. Lord, I pray for those that are not saved, that they would take that step of faith today. For those that are, that they would understand the gospel more clearly, that they would be able to present it more clearly. And Lord, as we go into the week, that we would see many young people confronted with the gospel, and then parents as well after. Pray, Lord, that you would use this in our hearts today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Have you ever wondered how to effectively present the gospel to people? The gospel is something that all of us have heard before, I'm sure. Many of us, maybe perhaps some of us haven't, but many of us have heard the gospel before. We've heard at least the term gospel used. I want to talk this morning for a few minutes about what the gospel is and how we can present it and what it means to us. Because this week we are going to be confronted with that fact. My purpose is to define the gospel and explain how it works and what it does. First of all, I want you to see the gospel's definition. Notice it says, it's called that down there, verse number 1. "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you." Gospel simply means glad tidings or good news. It's the idea of finding out how you can go to heaven when you die. You see, all of us deserve something else, according to Scripture. And the Bible gives us the gospel, and that is the good news. We all deserve bad news. The fact that we talk about the gospel, the fact that we're talking about good news, demands the reality of the opposite. You see, we are all born sinners, and we deserve the punishment for our sin, which is death. And so there is, according to the Bible, the gospel, which is good news that can keep us from dying forever. We'll talk about it here in just a minute, but that's what the gospel literally means. It means glad tidings or good news. Now, the gospel is not just about something called the gospel. The gospel is actually about a person. It's called the gospel of Christ. God's dear Son, of course, we're talking about God, His Son, God the Father, His Son, Jesus Christ. This is the good news of Jesus Christ. So the gospel is about good news, and it's about the person named Jesus Christ and what He did for us. It's talked about here in this passage in the first four verses. So that's the definition. It's good news. But secondly, there's a deliverer for the gospel. Notice it says, "I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you." The Apostle Paul is speaking here, and he is saying to the church in Corinth, he's saying, "Look, I declared unto you the gospel. I was the one that preached it unto you." Anytime you hear good news, it's because someone published it. I don't know about you, but I love to hear good news. How many of you like to hear good news? Good. How many of you ever had somebody come up to you and say, "I've got good news and I've got bad news. Which one do you want first?" You ever had anybody do that to you? Boy, what do you say? See, why don't you just go leave me alone? I don't care. I don't want to hear anything. Of course, good news is something that we all like to hear. I remember one time when I was, I would say 21 years old. No, 24 years old. Sorry about that. 1999. I was walking home from school one day. I went out to the mailbox, and I opened up, there was a letter in there from a publishing company, a music publishing company. And not only was there a letter in there, there was also a check. a big, huge check. I had written some arrangements, and they were published and accompaniment with a piano accompaniment and everything. And I received that check in the mail. And I tell you what, that day was a really, really exciting day for me. Not only not just because I received a bunch of money for publishing those arrangements. That wasn't the only reason. But I used that money to go and to buy, what do you think? An engagement ring. And I got married 15 years later, or not 15 years, I got married a year later, and I've been married for 15 years. Oh, boy. Okay. I will tend my resignation after the service. Okay. I didn't come out quite right there. Okay, so that married, about 6 months, or no, 8 months, something like that later, in the month of July 22nd, the year 2000, and I've been married for 15 years coming up here next Wednesday. So, but anyway, that was good news. I tell you, that day was exciting. I remember opening up that check and thinking, oh man, this is really, really neat. I was so thrilled. I was just so excited. Don't you love getting good news? Don't you love it? Well, there's really three things about the deliverance of the gospel. The first thing, it's preached. Mark chapter 16, verse 15 says, and he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Now, some of you have a Strong's Concordance, or you have a Bible program or something like that. I want you to sometime do a study about the term gospel. Whenever you look at the term gospel, you will find that the gospel is always preached. I didn't take the time to count it up. But there was at least 25, 30 times that you see the term gospel and then you see the term preached beside it. Why? Because the gospel is preached to people. Preaching is just the idea of forthtelling the truth. It can be in the form of literal preaching, where I'm standing up here preaching it. It can be in the form of written preaching. It can be in the form of sung preaching. You ever heard anybody sing the gospel in a song? Well, we sang it this morning. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. That's the gospel. It can be in the form of example preaching. Did you know that you preach something every time you walk out the door of your house? You tell everybody, hey, I'm a Christian, or I'm not a Christian. I'm saved and on my way to heaven, or I'm not saved and on my way to heaven. Depending on what you do, how you look, how you act, where you go, the things you say, the things you listen to, all say something about your life. And can be an effective presentation of the gospel. Or you can just simply go and tell people the gospel, one-on-one. Preaching here or preaching one-on-one with people. The gospel is preached, but also the gospel is powerful. Romans chapter 1, verse 16 says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, because it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. People try to do everything today but simply preach the gospel. Have you ever seen anybody that just goes in their preaching or their teaching, they go every which way around the gospel, but they never actually hit it? You ever seen anybody do that? It's like they're trying not to offend people. Why? Why should we not offend people? Well, we shouldn't be offending people, but why worry about that? The Bible says to preach the gospel. Apostle Paul wasn't ashamed of it. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. I've seen many people come to Jesus Christ after hearing the gospel once. But you know, I've also seen many people come to know Jesus Christ after hearing the gospel many times. Regardless, the gospel is powerful. You know, many times it just simply takes someone to preach it effectively to have success and to see someone come to know the Lord. I remember back a few years ago, I was out doing some door-to-door soul winning with another missionary that I was with in a missions conference. And we were going door-to-door, and we were talking to people, just introducing them to Jesus Christ. And he was the elder, one of us two, and so I let him go first. And he presented the gospel with somebody. And then I came to a door and I presented the gospel to a man. And I went through the whole plan of salvation with him, got to a point of decision. And he rejected the Lord Jesus Christ and said, I don't want to do that. I'm not ready yet, which is fine. So he walked away and we walked away. And when we did, the missionary looked at me and he said, brother, you just have a way. And I said, wait a minute, hold on a second. I don't have necessarily a way to present the gospel. He said, no, you have a way with people. I said, no, don't. No, I don't necessarily. You know what that is? That's a combination of the power of the gospel presented effectively and the Holy Spirit of God working in the heart of the person that's listening. See, when you put those two together, it's a powerful combination. It's preaching, but it's preaching something that's powerful. But you know, also in the delivery, the gospel can be provoking. In other words, it can excite to action. Sometimes the action is not always what we want. You ever had somebody, when you presented the gospel to them, they got mad at you? I've had that happen before. Not because I was trying to make them mad, but because they were confronted with truth. And you know what that was? That was conviction of the Holy Spirit. Many times that's what it is. People can get mad when presented with the gospel, but that does not necessarily mean that the Lord's not working in their heart. Sometimes they're mad because he is working in their heart. Because they don't want to get right about their sin, or they don't want to take that step of faith so they can go to heaven. But the one important thing to remember about the gospel, that it does have an effect in some way on the person that is hearing it. The Bible says that God's word will not return void, and the gospel is included in his word. I've never seen a person that heard the gospel not react to it. I've never seen that happen. I've never seen them just go, whatever, walk away. No, they are always confronted with the truth. Many times, I remember one time I was sitting in a booth at a fair, and we were trying to engage people in conversations about the gospel, and there were five young people that came up to the booth. And they were very much scorners. They were mocking what we were trying to do. And I brought them into the tent, and I asked them if I could share with them the gospel. They said, sure, absolutely. And they did so because they wanted to make fun of us. Well, I began to present the gospel to them in a very clear and precise manner, and I applied it directly to them, one person at a time. I said, are you a sinner? Yes, I am. And some of them laughed, you know, whatever. And I presented the gospel to them. And by the time I was done, they walked out of that tent very sober. Now, none of them actually received Jesus Christ that day. None of them got saved, but they were very, very sober. Why? Because the gospel has a tremendous effect on people because it's provoking. It's provoking. When I say provoking, I'm not meaning that in a bad way. I'm not provoking them to anger. It's just that the gospel, because of its power and done effectively, can have a tremendous effect on people. It has a very sobering effect on people. Why? Well, we'll see in just a minute. Why? Because of what the gospel really is. So many times people will either be convicted, or they'll get saved, or they'll convicted, get mad, or they will convicted, reject Christ. Maybe they'll turn around, walk away, whatever, but they're convicted. I think I told you the story about a man who I sat next to on an airplane. I presented him with the gospel, told him he was a sinner, and the rest of the trip, he sat there just agitated, disturbed, visibly disturbed by the fact that he was a sinner and that he needed Jesus Christ and he was on his way to a Christless eternity. I think probably sitting in an airplane, knowing that it could go down at any second, perhaps had some effect on him. Quite possibly it did. And knowing that he was rejecting the very thing that could help him. And I'll never forget him walking away saying, you know what? I just have too much living to do. And rejecting Jesus Christ. Well, you know what, my friends? It's a very foolish thing to do. But he was confronted by it, and he was provoked into action. So he took that step of rejecting it. And I've seen it happen many times with people when they're confronted with the gospel, that they either respond positively, they respond negatively, or they at least respond in some way under conviction of their sin. The third thing I want you to see is the gospel's description. It's talked about here in this passage of Scripture. Many passages contain the gospel, and I'm convinced that we need to be very careful and we present the gospel to people, that we do it in such a way that they can understand it the very first time. And it can be. It's a very simple thing to understand. Notice I didn't say believe it the first time, but at least understand it the first time. I've met a lot of people who have made a decision for the Lord in church or whatever, but they didn't understand what they were doing. My wife and I were doing some door-to-door work one time up in Michigan. We knocked on the door, and we talked to this young man about the gospel. And he said, yeah, I did this back when I was a kid, and I was taken into a room, and the man prayed for me, and I think that was the moment I got saved. And I talked to him a little bit more and found out he just basically let somebody else pray for him. He basically let somebody else do the trusting for him, and he never really got saved. Well, that's because the worker that was dealing with him wasn't being careful enough with the gospel. And it's very important for us to be clear in our presentation of the gospel so that we don't leave people confused. I try to be as thorough as I can be presenting the gospel. And I also try to ask people questions while I'm going through it to make sure that they understand what I'm saying. Some people get it the first time. Some people get it after a long time. Some people I take 10, 15 minutes with and they're done. Some people it takes an hour. But usually by the time I'm done, if it's presented effectively, they will understand it. There was a man who I met up in Ohio. It took like 15 to 20 minutes for me to go through the gospel, but he completely understood everything without me having to rush through it. And he got saved that day. See, we don't need to be so worried about the numbers and winning so many people to the Lord or whatever that we fail to explain the gospel correctly to people. So what is the gospel? How is it defined? How can somebody know for sure that they're going to heaven? Because that's what the gospel is for. The gospel is so that we can have eternal life. If we believe the gospel, which is about Jesus Christ, then we can have eternal life, who is Jesus Christ. And that's a wonderful thing. So what is the gospel? Really, I sum it up in three different points. The first one is this, sin. Sin. The Bible says down here in verse number 3, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the scripture. People need to be lost in order to be saved. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3 says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. We need to take as much time as we can on this section here about sin. We don't rush through the idea of sin. But what is sin? Has everybody sinned? Well, the Bible says that very clearly. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 3:10 says, there's none righteous, no, not one. There's nobody in the world that can say, you know what, I've never sinned. I've never done anything wrong. Because if we're honest and didn't lie, which is a sin, by the way, we'd have to admit that we have sinned sometime or other. All of us have. We're all guilty of it. For as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so that death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Isaiah chapter 64 says, for we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. And we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquity like the wind hath taken us away. Isaiah 53, all we like sheep have gone astray, and turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Everybody in the world is guilty of sin. Sin is basically breaking one of God's commandments. God's commandments are scattered all throughout Scripture. We find one in Exodus chapter 20 that says, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Have you ever told a lie? You're guilty of sin. You're guilty of breaking God's commandments. And you know what you need? You need to understand that you're a sinner. You need to understand that you have broken God's law. The Bible just simply says that sin is the transgression of the law. We are guilty of breaking God's commandments. All of us have. But you know, there's another part to this concept that I want you to understand, and that's this. There's a punishment for our sin. When you were a kid, did you ever face the consequences for your sin? When you did something wrong, did you get in trouble? I sure hope you did, because that's what helps you to do right. I know I sure did. I know when I was growing up, if I did something wrong, I faced the consequences for it. I really did. Many, many times. In fact, if my mother were here this morning, she would have to admit, she would be the first one to admit. She'd probably take a close, probably tie. She'd probably tie with my wife to be the first one in line to say that I'm a sinner, okay? Because they know that I am. But my mother, she can tell you many, many illustrations, examples of when I was a kid and the things that I did that were wrong. Like what? Like doing things that boys do. Doing things that we shouldn't do as boys. Like going out into the backyard and digging a huge, giant hole, filling it with water, and then wallowing in the mud. It was fun. But it was a sin, okay? And I suffered the consequences for it down in the basement, okay? I remember that very well. But all of us are guilty of that, aren't we? Are we guilty of sin? Well, if we break one of God's commandments, then you know what? We deserve the punishment for our sin, and I got punished for what I did. Time and time and time again, give you many examples of my sin. But you know, the Bible says that the punishment is pretty severe. Romans chapter 6, verse 23 says, "For the wages of sin is death." Boy, that sounds pretty serious. If you ever work a job, you get paid for it, you get wages. Well, the payment for my sin is death. Now, that's not just a physical death, though all of us will die someday. Physically, we will die. That's a spiritual death or an eternal death. It takes place in a spot called hell. Now, we use the term, I use it reverently because it is a very, very serious place. Some people say, "I'm going to go to hell and I'm going to party with my buddies." Listen, I can tell you, friend, there's nobody in hell today that's partying with their buddies. Why? Because hell is a serious, awful place. Luke chapter 16 talks about it. It says, "And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and he seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom." The man was in torments. Why? Because of his sin. He deserved the punishment for his sin, which is death and hell. I don't have time to talk about it. There's a whole lot more to talk about with the matter of sin, the matter of hell and death that we deserve. But the point is this: because I sin, I deserve the punishment for my sin. Now, somebody may look at that and say, "Boy, that's pretty harsh, isn't it? That's pretty serious. Why would a God who loves everybody send anybody to such an awful place? Doesn't God love people?" Well, yeah, he does. But God is also just. The Bible says, "Our God is a rock, but he is just. Just and right is he." So I will get what I deserve. We wouldn't say that a parent was just if their child did something wrong and they didn't punish him for it, would we? Would we say that they were just? Well, no, we wouldn't. What about our judicial system? Would we say that a judge was just if they just let prisoners go or criminals go every time? No, why? Because they didn't get what they deserve. See, the point is, we sin and we deserve the punishment for our sin. And you can argue about it till you're blue in the face, friend, but I'm telling you, the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. And I will get what I deserve. Romans 21, verse 8 says, "But the fearful and unbelieving and abominable and whoremongers and adulterers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." See, I deserve the punishment for my sin. And that punishment is death and hell. And it doesn't just last for a little while. Listen, friends, it lasts forever. It lasts for all eternity. And I'm not going to go into the details about sin and death and hell. But the point is this. You know what? We all are sinners. And we all deserve the punishment for our sin. But that really brings me to the second thing. The first thing, the first matter to talk about in the matter of the gospel is sin. All of us are sinners and we deserve the punishment for our sin, which is death. But the second thing to talk about in the matter of the gospel is Christ. Christ. Jesus Christ came to earth for a reason. Look down there at verse number 3 again. "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures." Jesus Christ came for one reason only, and that was to pay the price for our sins. We've been studying in the book of Genesis about God's wonderful plan of redemption started back in the Garden of Eden. The Bible says that after Eve sinned, it says, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." In other words, the devil will be dealt a death blow sometime or other. Well, then God, in his miraculous way, planned for redemption for man. A man named Abraham came on the scene and he said, "In thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed." You know what? That's talking about you. That's talking about me. Everybody on earth will be blessed through the man named Abraham. Through his line, we can follow down all the way through Jesus Christ. And we can find prediction, prophecy after prophecy after prophecy throughout the Old Testament fulfilled in the man Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was not just another man. He was God himself. Came down here in the form of a man. He became the incarnate one, the one who the Bible calls Emmanuel, God with us. And the purpose of Jesus coming to earth was to die on the cross for the sins of the whole world. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 3, there's one little word in there that's so important. How that Christ died for our sins. F-O-R. That little word. It's important. Jesus Christ died for my sins. Now notice death. I deserve to die for what I've done, according to what the Bible says. I deserve to die for my sins. But Jesus came and he died for me. In other words, he took my place on the cross. He died for me. Romans 5:8. But God commendeth or showed his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I deserve to die for what I've done. I deserve the punishment for my sin, which is death and hell. And listen, friend, I'm going to face it without the love of Jesus Christ. And Jesus came to die for our sins. The Bible says in 1 John 2:2, he is the propitiation or the substitute for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Jesus died for me. But you know, there's another wonderful truth in this passage that I haven't addressed yet, and that's this. Verse number 4, and that he was buried. By the way, you don't bury people that are alive. Jesus was dead when he died on the cross. He was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures. We celebrate Easter because Jesus rose. You know, that's why we are dogmatic and emphatic about the fact that what we believe is right. It's because Jesus is alive. Jesus is the one that died on the cross, but yes, Jesus rose again. And he's the only one that can give us eternal life because he's alive today. You look at every other religion in the world today and you cannot find one other religious leader that's still alive today. Amen. Because they're all dead. I'm not trying to be unkind. I'm just simply saying Jesus died, but he rose again. And the reason he rose again is so that he can show us that he had victory over sin and death. Genesis 3, verse 15, we go back to that. It says, thou shalt bruise his head, or he shall bruise his head, but thou shalt bruise his heel. The devil was dealt a death blow at the cross of Calvary. When Jesus yelled, it is finished on the cross, you know what he was saying? The victory over sin and death has been won. No longer do people have to die and go to hell. They can go to heaven. Salvation's plan is done. Redemption's plan is finished. It is finished. And the devil has been dealt a death blow. And you know, at that moment, the sins of mankind had been paid for in full. You know, you think about it. Let's say that as a parent, I have a child who needs to be punished for something. Well, what if my other child came in and right before the punishment said, you know what? They deserve to be punished for what they did, but you know what? I'll take their punishment for them. Now, I don't think I can ever see that happening. Okay, just knowing my children, I know it would never happen, but I'll let you say that one of them did that. Would that not be very kind and sweet? But you know, that's what Jesus Christ did for us on a much greater level. We deserve to face the punishment for our sins with death and hell forever and ever. And ever, but Jesus came and died on the cross and took our punishment, took our place so that we don't have to go to hell. Listen, that's the epitome of love. But God commendeth or showed his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He took our place on the cross. Down here in this passage, it says, and if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. But now, in verse 20 says, but now is Christ risen from the dead and become the firstfruits of them that slept. See, if Christ had died and not risen again, it wouldn't have made any difference. But now is Christ risen from the dead. Jesus is alive so that we can have eternal life. So the first thing about the gospel is that we're a sinner. Secondly, we deserve the punishment for our sin, which is death and hell. Jesus Christ came and died on the cross for our sins. And then third thing we need to understand is faith. Sin, Christ, and faith. These three things are the real truths about the gospel. We talk about faith. This is about faith and trust in the only one that can save me. This is about faith and trust in the one that died for me, Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. Faith is dependence. It's trust. It's reliance. It's belief on. This faith is what we would call a transfer of dependence from whatever it is I'm depending on to Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. See, if somebody never transfers their dependence from whatever they're depending on to Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone, they're not saved. Now, some people like to add other things in there. They'll say, you know what? I put my faith and trust in Christ, and I'm trying real hard, and I'm going to go to church, and I'm going to get baptized, and all this stuff. Well, you know what? None of those things save you. You see, that's not trust in Christ and Christ alone. You say, well, why is that important? The Bible says very clearly in Acts chapter 4, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And you know what? That includes my name. That includes me. That includes you. There's nobody else on earth that can save me, but Jesus Christ can. And he is the only way. He himself even said it, John 14, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So then Jesus is the only one that can get me to heaven. And I must put my faith and trust in Christ and Christ alone to save me. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. See, it's not about what I do. It's not about all these good things that I do. It's about my faith and trust in Jesus and Jesus Christ alone that saves me. Listen, friend, has there ever been a time where you have come to a point where you said, you know what, I'm a sinner. I deserve to go to hell for what I've done. But I'm right now transferring my dependence from all these other things that I've been depending on to Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone to save me. Has there ever been a time where you did that? If not, you're not saved. And if not, you're on your way to a Christless eternity in hell forever and ever and ever. And you know, friend, that ought to scare you a little bit. That ought to concern you a little bit. Because if you died without Jesus Christ, that's where you would be forever. But you know, you don't have to leave here today wondering whether or not you're saved. You don't have to leave here wondering whether or not you are on your way to heaven. Because you can know for sure that you're saved. You can know for sure that you're on your way to heaven. Everybody can. But it's only by faith and trust in Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. I remember talking to a young man one time way up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, up in the Keweenaw Peninsula. And I was up there for a service, and I had a dad and his son that came forward after the service, and they wanted to talk to me about salvation. And we began to discuss this matter of sin, and they said, yeah, we're a sinner. I still think I'm saved. And you ever trusted in Jesus Christ? Well, yeah, I think I did at one time or another, blah, blah, blah. He talked to me a little bit more about this, and talked to me a little bit more about this matter of faith, putting your complete dependence and trust in Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone to save you. Well, you know what? He got to a point where he said, you know what? I don't think I ever did that. I said, well, let me illustrate it for you. Salvation is about faith and trust. It's about a transfer of dependence from whatever it is I'm depending on to Jesus and Jesus Christ alone. And so I put two chairs down there, and I moved my faith from one chair to the next chair. I said, this is the idea. It's a transfer of dependence. It's a transfer of faith from one chair to the next. I said, now, let me illustrate it this way. And I sat down between the two chairs. And I said, now, let me ask you, is this faith and trust in Jesus Christ completely? And he said, no, it's not. I said, why? Because you're trusting in both of them. I said, exactly right. somebody cannot put their faith and trust in Christ alone if they're trusting in something else. It's not possible. What I must do is transfer my faith from this chair to this one completely, period. Well, after a few minutes, he looked up and he said, you know what, I think I need to be saved. I said, well, why is that? He said, because I've never trusted in Jesus Christ alone. He didn't put it this way. He said, I'm still trusting in two chairs. He understood the concept. It's transfer of my faith from whatever it is I'm depending on to Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. Listen, friend, when you do that, the Bible says that you are saved. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Saved from what? Saved from your sin and saved from hell. I tell you what, that's a wonderful thing. And you know, when you're saved, you pass, the Bible says, from death unto life, never to go back to death again. Never. And that's a wonderful thing. That really is. Which really brings me to the last thing here, which is the gospel's deliverance. The Bible says down here, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved. What does the gospel do for us? What is it? How does it deliver us? First of all, it saves us. It saves us forever. It's my assurance. Many people doubt their salvation. Well, listen, friend, if you're saved, the Bible says that you have passed from death unto life. If you are saved, you have eternal life. 1 John chapter 5 says, these things are written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life. How long does eternal life last? Lasts forever. I know that's kind of a dumb question, maybe. All right, but eternal life doesn't stop. It goes on and on and on and on and on. Well, when do I get eternal life? I get eternal life as soon as I'm saved. As soon as I put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone, at that moment, I have eternal life. So you know what? As I stand here this morning, I have eternal life. And you know what? If you are saved, if you're a blood-bought child of God, you know what you are? You're saved, but you have eternal life too. And eternal life lasts forever. It doesn't stop. We can have assurance of our salvation knowing that we are on our way to heaven forever and ever and ever. Why? Because of what the Bible says. Eternal life doesn't stop. And our desire is for everyone in this room and in the world to know for sure they're on their way to heaven. So the gospel's deliverance, first of all, it saves. But secondly, you know what it does? It sanctifies. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand. Ye stand. See, it helps me with my walk with the Lord. You know, if I'm doubting my salvation, I'll never make it past the spiritual infant stage. But if I can come to a point where I say, you know what, I'm saved, I have eternal life, there's nothing that can change that. There's nothing I can do to have that taken away. I have eternal life. And there's nothing anybody else can do to take that salvation away from me. There's nothing anybody else can do to take away my eternal life. And there's absolutely nothing the devil can do that can take away that eternal life because I have it and I have it forever. When I come to that point, you know what I'm doing? I'm standing on the gospel. And I'm standing on it so it can help me in my walk with the Lord. You know, when I defend my faith, this is something I can stand on. They can try to trip me up as much as they want. But you know what? They cannot argue with the fact that I have put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ and that I am saved and I am saved forever. Nobody can take that away from me. But you know what? Also, as a Christian, without the doctrine of salvation, I have nothing. I have nothing I can stand on. It's like what the Bible says, I am of all men most miserable. You know, I remember a time in my life where I doubted my salvation. I doubted it every day. Then there came a point in my life where the Lord got a hold of me and said, your problem is not that you need to get saved. Your problem is that you need to get right with me. And you know what? After that moment, I never doubted my salvation one more time. And I haven't doubted it since. Listen, friend, you can know for sure you're going to heaven. But it's only by accepting the gospel. And you know, this week we'll be confronted with unsaved people all around us. What can you tell them? The gospel. The gospel's powerful. It's provoking. It will deliver. But it's pretty simple. It's not something that needs to be complicated. It's sin, Christ, and faith. If you're here without Jesus Christ, you know what? We want to help you with that. We want you to leave here knowing for sure that you're on your way to heaven. We don't want you to walk out of here doubting your salvation. We don't want you to walk out of here wondering whether or not that you're going to go out and get in a car accident and die and find your way and find yourself in hell for all eternity. We don't want you to have that fear in your heart. We want you to know for sure you're going to heaven. And you can know it today before you leave. But also, Christian, you know, we need to be clear in our presentation of the gospel. We need to be able to explain it to people and explain it effectively. And I hope that this is a help in doing so. Let's bow our heads in prayer, can we?